All right, so here we are inside of a blank project with the starter content. Now I have opened up the starter map. So you'll find that within your starter content, though you will need to go to File, Open Map to get to it. And we are going to create our own custom material. We'll start off by making it very, very basic. And then as we move forward, we'll add some textures to it and we'll turn it into something practical. After we've made something practical, we'll make something that is just cool. All right, so for starters, we need something that we can work on. Now in this level, we have several different objects that are floating around that are perfect for showing off a material. Now I'll give you kind of a heads up just to be completely transparent. I'm working on an early version of the engine, kind of pre-release. So what you see here in the starter content might be slightly different than what I have here. So if you end up seeing a different object, that's okay. You should be seeing something. And no matter what you see, it will work for our purposes. But what I'm going to do is select this object and hold down Alt and the Shift key. And I'm going to drag this to the side. Now by holding down Alt, I'm making a copy. And by holding down Shift, I'm moving the camera with us. So I get a nice clean slide over here, and I get a brand new surface to work on. Now, time for us to make a material. Now, materials are Unreal assets that are created in the content browser. So I'm going to move over here to the content browser in the lower left-hand corner of my view. If for some reason you don't see it, for some reason maybe you've closed it or it's not there, you can click on the content browser button up in the toolbar, and that should bring it back for you, even if it is floating. It could be anywhere if you've moved it around. Hopefully, you are close to your default settings, and it's over here in the lower left corner. So let's go under the materials folder. And there's already several different materials that exist here inside this folder that we can already look at. Now, adding materials to a surface is extremely easy. Really, all you have to do is drag and drop out of the content browser, and your material will automatically be applied. So for instance, if I take this grass material here and I drag that onto the ground and let go, we get grass on the surface. Very quick and easy. And if I drag in this copper, boom, we get copper instead. I'm actually going to hit Control Z a couple times and get it back to where it was. Now, I want to apply a material to this surface, this little sphere looking demo plaque thing. I'm not sure what this is, but it does look really cool. So if I grab, say, the copper and I just drag it on here, it covers up the entire surface. Now this allows me to mention just casually, without it becoming too much of a distraction, the concept of material elements. So for those of you who have ever created 3D content in 3ds Max or Maya, when you have multiple materials assigned or applied to an object, each different material that you have applied to a single surface creates a separate material element when you bring that object into Unreal Engine 4. So here we have two elements. We have element 0, which is this base steel that you see covering the outside of our surface. And we have element 1, it's a zero base list, which is the little Unreal Engine trappings that are kind of around the outside. So what I'm going to do is grab my copper, and instead of dragging and dropping on the surface like I did a second ago, I'm going to drag this straight into the details panel, right on top of element 0, and let go. And you'll notice it only assigned the material to that one element, which is extremely useful and very cool looking. You see all those nice reflections. Now, with that understood, now we know how to apply materials. Let's take a look at creating our own. So here in the materials folder within the content browser, I'm going to right-click on a blank space, and you'll see that I have the ability to create a new material right here. Another way to do that is to come over to the New Asset button and click that and choose Material. It does the exact same thing, just whichever one you're more comfortable with. Depending on your settings in the content browser, it may be difficult to find a blank area in here to actually right-click and create a material. So in those cases, just use the New Asset button. Now this will create a brand new material that you need to rename. So I'll call this my material, which is extremely descriptive, as I'm sure you'd agree. And now we're going to open this up in the material editor. So I'll just double click like so. Now here's your crash course to the material editor. At the very top, we have a toolbar with some common functions that we're going to be using a fair chunk of these as we move forward, but not all of them, because this is just kind of, like I said, kind of an introduction. We have our preview window, which you can left click and drag and rotate around. If you see a grid in here, you can actually turn that off with a little grid button here in the upper right-hand corner. So if you like seeing the grid, cool, leave it on. If you don't, turn it off. We have the details panel. This is where we'll change all of our different material properties as we work with the various nodes and connections that will define this material. And we have our graph area. This is where all of our nodes are going to be placed. Now on the right-hand side, we have our palette. This is a list of all of the different types of nodes we have access to. Now, I'll be completely honest. Everyone has a different workflow, but I tend not to use this list very often, primarily because you can get access to the exact same thing just by right-clicking here inside the view and then quickly typing out what you want. However, if you're just getting started and you don't really know what you have access to, then the palette becomes very useful. Another nice little feature of the palette is it shows you the various hotkeys you have that will allow you to quickly create certain nodes. For instance, if I need a constant, which is just a node that holds a single value, a single float number, I can hold down the 1 key and click here in the graph, and that will create a constant node. And there's a whole bunch of these. So for instance, if I need to make a multiply node to multiply two values together, I can hold down the M key, M as in Mike, and click, and there you go. It just magically appears. The palette gives you quick access to all of those different hotkeys. Just scroll down, and you'll see each one listed. So it's very, very useful for that. So let's go ahead and start making our new material a little more interesting. Now, just a quick heads up, if you haven't yet done anything to a material, and you try to apply it, which I'm going to do now, I'm going to slide my material editor out of the way for just a moment. And you can see my material here in the content browser. I'm just going to drag that over to the details panel and release the mouse. And there you go. Now, there is a slight discrepancy that you'll notice here. In the preview, we should have a black material. That is expected because we haven't really done anything to our material. We've left everything at their default values. However, when you apply this within a scene, you'll notice that you get this default material with a little grid texture applied. This is just so that it is quick and easy for you to identify materials that don't have anything going on with them. Also, if you ever end up breaking a reference somehow, or you delete content out of your project that is in use in your scene, then you will notice this material will apply anywhere where you are missing content. So generally, when you see this default material, that is, I guess I should say, that could be a bad thing. In this case, it just means we've got a material where nothing is currently going on. So we're going to do stuff to this material, but we're going to spend most of our time looking at the preview so we don't have to keep jumping back and forth to the actual scene. So for starters, let's change the color of our material. And here you can already see that base color input. And this node that you see here, this is our material node. This is really the highest level of our material, and we're going to plug other nodes into this. So to get a color, we need a vector 3 constant. Now, that sounds like a long way to say color. If you're a complete layperson, you're like, well, don't you just have a color node? And the answer is not really, and here's why. First off, if we look here in the list, in the palette, we can see there's a constant 3 vector, which I can just drag and drop that over, like so. Alternatively, I can right click, and I can type 3 vector, and I can create it like that. Or as you saw earlier, I can hold down the 3 key and just click, and that'll create one like so. Now, the reason it's not just called color is because you may not always be using this node to store color. A vector 3 is just a number with 3 elements, and you might be using any one of those elements for a lot of different things. It's kind of a programmer-style term. So let's go ahead and just double-click on that node. And you saw as I did that, that brought up the color picker. So we're going to slide this over to a brilliant orange. We'll make sure the value gets lifted all the way up. So I have a really bright, intense, somewhat obnoxious shade of orange, and we'll connect that right over to base color. And to connect it, all I'm doing is just mousing over this pin, drag over, and you'll see that gives you a wire, and plug that straight into base color. Very intuitive, and I can reposition this node just by clicking and dragging on it. And you'll see that wire stays connected. So we have our first connection to the material taken care of. And you can see how base color works. We can double click and choose any other color we want. And you'll see that your material updates. For now, I'm going to leave mine over on orange. That's a little too yellow. Let's push that a little more toward red. There we go. I like that a lot better. Okay, so next, let's take a look at our metallic value. Now, as I mentioned in the previous video, metallic controls how metal-like the surface is, and most of the time, there's going to be a value of 0 or 1, and generally nothing in between. So let's hold down the 1 key, and if you take a look here in the palette, that's going to create a constant. So hold down 1 and click. And then this is just going to really hold a number as far as I'm concerned, and that means I don't really care what the preview thumbnail shows, so I'm just going to collapse that by clicking on this little white triangle in the upper right-hand corner. That makes the node nice and tiny, and it doesn't take up a lot of screen space, which I like. So with this node selected, I'm going to cut my eyes over here to the left in the details panel, and we'll set this to a value of 1, and then connect it to our metallic input. And suddenly, if you take a look, our preview now does indeed look like it is made of metal. So let's jump back and forth. Let's set this back to 0. And it looks kind of like plastic. And we'll set it to 1. And now it looks like metal. We can set it to something like 0.5. And there's where you get that kind of not quite realistic, partly metal, partly realistic look. Or partly metal, partly plastic. Anyway, so let's move on to our next input. Now, specular is a bit of a different creature. If you're coming to this from Unreal Engine 3, you may be tempted to apply specular color in here, and that is not how this works. Specular is actually kind of an artist's tweak for how specular or how shiny a surface is. I'm actually going to skip it and come back to it in just a moment. For now, let's take a look at roughness. Roughness, as I mentioned in the last video, is how rough the surface would feel at the near microscopic level. I guess you could say macroscopic level. I think that works. So let's create another constant value. Now, I've already got one node that is a constant here. I can hit Control-C, Control-V, and make a copy of that. And let's just drag this right over here to roughness. So we have a roughness value of 1. And this, again, as I mentioned earlier, looks very much like chalk, though you'll tend to leave this capped out at a value of around 0.9 or maybe 0.8. And you're starting to get just a little bit of that specular highlight right across the edge of the surface, but for the most part, it's pretty muted. Now, if we pull this all the way down to 0, we have a perfectly reflective material. And you can see in this case, it's picking up the result of a cube map with a little skybox. So a more realistic value might be something like 0.1. So you're getting just a little bit of blur in your reflection. If you want something like a perfect mirror, it might be something like 0.05. By the way, if you're interested in making something that looks like a mirror, all you'd really need to do is make sure your roughness is really low, make sure your metallic is at 1, then take your color and set that to white. And you essentially get a mirror. Now, I have had a couple of people who are totally new to this say, but Zach, a mirror is generally made of glass, and glass is not a metal, so why are you setting metallic to 1? Well, the truth is, all the mirrors in your home, like all the glass ones, actually have a metal backing. In some cases, I think they even use silver to back that, and the glass just kind of provides a reflective and protective coating to keep everything nice and shiny. So let's go ahead and put back our nice orange color. And let that process, and there we go. So now we have a nice metallic color. Now, let's set this back to something a little bit more realistic, something kind of rough, so we'll say about 0.4. Also, if I take my metallic and set it all the way down to 0, note the difference in reflection in terms of roughness. So if I take my roughness and set it to 0 with metallic also at 0, you see, we are getting nice, perfect reflections, but it really does look like polished plastic. Compare this to setting metallic back to 1, where you get more of the color of the surface coming through in the reflections, just as you would like on a glass Christmas ornament or something similar. So let's set this back to 0. And of course, if I set my roughness up to something high, like maybe 0.7, you see how things kind of start to look like sort of a corrugated plastic. Okay, now that allows me to take just a moment and show off specular. So let me pull this down to about 0.2. Specular is only going to work on non-metallic surfaces. So the moment your metallic is set to 1, specular suddenly ceases to exist, and that's important to note. But all this is really going to do is give you an artist tweak to how bright your specular reflections are. So let me, I won't create a node that way. I'll show you that one a little bit later. Let's make another copy of this constant. So I can also hit Control W, and that will just duplicate whatever I have selected. And the default value for specular is 0.5. So we'll just plug in the default value and nothing is going to change. Now watch as I lift this up to 1. You might have to look very closely, but you'll notice that at 1, those specular highlights, particularly the reflections of the clouds, which, let me pull this way down, something like, well, let's go all the way to 0, even though it's kind of unrealistic. And take a look. Here's the default value with a specular of 0.5. And you can see those clouds, but they're just a little bit muted into the surface. And then when I take specular and I boost it all the way to 1, you see the clouds become a lot brighter and a lot easier to see. Conversely, I can set specular to 0, and that removes my reflection. So again, this is just kind of an artist tweak. If you were to put a texture into this, this is a way to make sure that your darker areas on a non-metallic surface, as a reminder, are not reflecting very, very brightly. Now, in our case, we don't really need to worry about tweaking that. The default value is just fine. So I'm going to go ahead and delete this node. And with that, we have created a very, very simple material. So let's slide this out of the way for now. And then, oh, actually, let's not slide it out of the way. We've already applied it. And you can see over here in our view, it hasn't updated. I mean, here inside the material editor, we have this, you know, nice orange, shiny plastic. But in the scene, we actually see nothing. So let's make sure we fix that. To fix that, all we need to do is apply our changes. And I'm going to show this in the background, but we're going to click here in the material editor, click on the apply button. That will process our material, and as soon as it's done, we can actually see the update here live in the viewport. So with that, we have created a very, very basic material. You've seen how to make a material in the content browser, how to apply it by dragging and dropping it onto a surface, as well as how to apply it by dragging it into the details panel. That's going to wrap things up for this video. Thanks a lot.